In this video, we will review the joints of the wrist and the hand. We will progress gradually, starting with the most relevant structures of the osseous anatomy, then working through the cartilage, the synovial portions, the ligaments, and ending with the fibrocartilaginous structures. At the distal radius, the styloid process extends distally from the lateral region of the radius. On the dorsal surface, the dorsal tubercle of the radius separates the second and third extensor compartments. On the medial surface, we can see the ulnar notch for articulation with the head of the ulna. The distal surface is divided by a ridge in the sagittal plane into two articular areas, the triangular area for the scaphoid bone and the quadrangular area for the lunate bone. The distal end of the ulna forms the head, which is a cylindrical structure. The styloid process is located on the medial edge of the bone. The carpal bones are arranged into two rows. In the proximal row are the scaphoid, the lunate, the trichotym, and the pisiform. The distal row includes the hamate, the capitate, the trapezoid, and the trapezium. In a lateral view, we see that the scaphoid actually spans from the proximal to the distal row. The wrist is formed by the distal end of the radius and the ulna, and by the carpal bones. There are several components that participate in the movements of the wrist: the distal radial ulnar joint, the radial carpal joint, the ulnocarpal joint, and the midcarpal joint. Let's review the different wrist joints, starting with the distal radial ulnar joint. The ulnar notch of the radius is covered with cartilage. The head of the ulna is covered with cartilage in its lateral and distal surface. This joint is a trochoid type of synovial joint, in which the radius pivots around the head of the ulna. The ligaments are the dorsal radial ulnar ligament and the palmar radial ulnar ligament. These go from the dorsal and palmar edge of the ulnar notch to the base of the styloid process. There is an articular disc formed of fibrocartilage, which goes from the distal edge of the ulnar notch to the base of the styloid process. The ligaments in the disc join together to form the triangular fibrocartilaginous complex. The recessus sessiformis is a fold of the synovial capsule between the radius and the ulna that extends proximally. In the coronal plane, it is easier to see how the articular disc goes from the distal edge of the radial notch to the base of the styloid process of the ulna. Moving on to the radiocarpal joint, the triangular and quadrangular areas of the distal radius are covered with cartilage, as are the respective surfaces of the scaphoid and the lunate. The ulnocarpal joint is between the ulna and the trichotum. This region is unique in the sense that the triangular fibrocartilage complex is present between the ulna and the carpus, so there is no direct contact between the ulna and the trichotum. The bones of the carpus are linked by ligaments, known as the interosseous ligaments. So, in the proximal row, we have the scapholunate ligament and the lunotrichotal ligament, while in the distal row, we have the capitohamate ligament, the ligament between the capitate and the trapezoid, and the ligament in between the trapezoid and the trapezium. The midcarpal joint is formed between the first and second row of the carpus. All the surfaces involved are covered in cartilage. The interosseous ligaments of the proximal row are located in the proximal region. The interosseous ligaments of the distal row are located in the distal region. Thus, the midcarpal joint is a gliding surface in between the proximal and distal rows. The synovial capsule spreads along the articular surface and in between the bones, reaching as far as the respective interosseous ligaments. The wrist is stabilized by dorsal and carpal ligaments. There are various nomenclatures for these ligaments, but the basic idea is that there are dorsal radiocarpal ligaments, dorsal ulnocarpal ligaments, palmar radiocarpal ligaments, and palmar ulnocarpal ligaments. Going into further detail, the palmar radiocarpal ligaments can be described as the radioscaphocapitate ligament, the radioscapholunate ligament, the short radiolunate ligament, and the long radiolunate ligament. The palmar ulnocarpal ligaments can be described as the ulnolunate ligament, the ulnocapitate ligament, and the ulnotricotal ligament. The radiocarpal collateral ligament goes from the styloid process to the scaphoid tubercle, trapezium, and first metacarpal. The ulnar carpal collateral ligament inserts into the pisiform, the hook of the hamate, and the base of the fifth metacarpal. The dorsal radiocarpal ligament, more specifically, the dorsal radiolunotricotal ligament, goes from the radius into the lunate and the trichotome. Furthermore, the dorsal intercarpal ligament goes from the trichotome into the trapezoid, the trapezium, and the scaphoid. The carpometacarpal joints are those in between the carpal bones and the metacarpals. Those with long fingers have very little mobility, increasing from the radial to the ulnar joints. Individually, each joint is plane. They form a single synovial space. The palmar and dorsal carpometacarpal ligaments provide the stability to this joint. The thumb carpometacarpal joint is special. It is comprised of the trapezium and the base of the first metacarpal. It is a saddle synovial type of joint and highly mobile. The intermetacarpal joints are plane synovial joints in between the bases of the second to fifth metacarpals. Distal to the cartilaginous articular surfaces, there is a syndesmosis, which is the interosseous metacarpal ligament. The stability is complemented by the dorsal and palmar interosseous intermetacarpal ligaments. The metacarpal phalangeal joints are synovial condylar joints. From a lateral and volar viewpoint, we can observe that the head of the metacarpal forms a single condyle covered by cartilage in the distal and palmar surface. The base of the first phalanx forms a concavity covered with cartilage. This joint is stabilized by the collateral ligaments, which run from the tubercle at the side of the metacarpal head to the base of the phalanx. The origin of these ligaments is not in the axis of rotation of the condyle. As it is not isometric, in flexion, the distance between the origin and the insertion is longer than in extension. Thus, it tightens in flexion and loosens in extension. As a result, the range of adduction and abduction is greater when the metacarpal phalangeal joint is in extension. The palmar ligament is a fibrocartilaginous structure that originates at the palmar edge of the base of the phalanx. It becomes thinner as it goes into the loose insertion of the neck of each metacarpal with two check rein extensions. It slides under the head during extension and flexion. The deep transverse metacarpal ligament joins the second to the fifth palmar ligaments. The inner phalangeal joints, both proximal and distal, are synovial trochlear joints. The head of the proximal and middle phalanges form a trochlea in the distal and palmar surface. The base of the middle and distal phalanges form a concavity covered with cartilage. This joint is stabilized by the collateral ligaments, which run from the head of one phalanx to the base of the next phalanx. Once again, the palmar ligament, also called the palmar plate, is a fibrocartilaginous structure that originates at the palmar edge of the base of the phalanx. It becomes thinner as it goes into the loose insertion of the neck of the proximal phalanx, with two check rein extensions. As this joint is trochlear, there is flexion and extension, but no adduction or abduction.